The Jerry Powell Podcast is brought to you by Archstone Foundation, preparing society and meeting the needs of an aging population. And now, here are your hosts.
Welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast. This is Eric Rodera.
This is Alex Smith.
And Alex, who do we have on the Zoom Jerry Powell Podcast?
Today, we have Lauren Mu, who's a cognitive behavioral neurologist. I believe the first cognitive behavioral neurologist we've had on Jerry Powell. She is at the Massachusetts General Hospital and at the VA in Bedford, Massachusetts. Welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast, Lauren.
Thanks so much.
And Lauren, we're going to be talking about, you had a wonderful recent paper in the Journal of American Geriatric Society, JAGS, on home video visits, 2D view of the geriatric 5Ms. Love to talk to you about kind of what you're doing as far as assessment and a little bit more about the article. But before we do, you have a song request for Alex.
I do. I'd like Alex to play Video Killed the Radio Star.
And can you tell us why?
Well, it seems it's a song about video taking over the older modalities, and it's actually an interesting song. It turns out that video for that song was the first video that was broadcast when MTV was new. So it's
really?
Yeah, so it's really all about sort of shifting paradigms in terms of, you know, media and approaches.
I didn't realize that was the first. That's awesome. All right, Here's a little bit of the beginning.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intent on tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through. They took the credit for your second symphony, rewritten by machines and new technology. And now I understand the problems you can see. I met your children. What did you tell them? Video kill the radio star. Video kill the radio star. Pictures came and broke your heart.
You don't have that sweet setup anymore, Alex, like you do at home. Alex has like this incomplete setup at home with echo devices, nice speakers. And
well, just to clarify, for the podcast, those of you who are listening, which is most of you, you will hear that version.
We're going to re-record it.
Re-record it. Well, I think the mix of the sort of acoustic and simple version may be appropriate as well.
Lauren, sure. I'd love just a little history. Like before February, March of this COVID year, were you doing a lot of video visits, telemedicine?
I was. I've actually been doing video visits for dementia management with video into the home since 2013. So I was an early adopter.
Wow.
Yeah. So.
And how was it going prior to COVID as far as doing your visits? And what do you do during your visits?
So I have, again, pre-pandemic, most of my visits were dementia follow-up visits. So seeing patients who had already been established to have some kind of dementia, either by me or somebody else in in-person brick-and-mortar clinic. But then the subsequent sort of management visits were by video into their home just because it was a lot. Well, first I thought it was cool, but also families seemed to think it was more convenient and easier for them instead of having to come into the clinic, especially because a lot of the visits were talking. There's not, you know, lots of hands-on assessment after the initial diagnosis. So talking about how somebody's doing in terms of their cognition, their behavior, their mood, home safety issues. Have there been any, you know, wandering incidents or falls? Have they had any problems with sleep disruption, continence? What kind of status they are in regarding ADLs and, you know, IADLs and stuff like that? Essentially, you know, finding out how they're doing, and depending on the patient's stage of dementia, that would either be a conversation largely with them, with the sort of family member by their side, or half and half, or in later stages, often it's mostly an informant telling me. But really not very different than an in-person visit. in terms of the content.
And did you see any benefits of doing these video visits over having them come in, besides just families liking, you know, not having to go to clinic?
Definitely from the family point of view, it was convenience regarding travel. So, you know, and again, you said I'm in Massachusetts, so whether, you know, most people with dementia, their primary family caregiver is a spouse. So usually the primary caregiver is also an older adult who, you know, having them travel in inclement weather is challenging as well. But other than that sort of convenience factor, one of the other main things that that families told me their reason for liking them was a decrease in how much the routine of the person with dementia was disrupted. That, you know, getting ready to, it wasn't just the literally the travel, but the planning for travel, having to wake up early, being sort of agitated about the visit, worried about the visit on the part of the person with dementia, that would really throw off sometimes the day before and the whole day after the visit. So it was really disruptive to come in terms of how the person with dementia would behave. And so families really appreciated that there was less disruption because it was just, you know, half an hour in their house. So that, from the family point of view, was the other main benefit that they reported to us. From my perspective, I really like the idea that you can see people and their behavior potentially in their actual context. So sometimes people are on better behavior when they're at the doctor's and they don't, you know, display some of their behaviors that they really do at home, and they might display those behaviors that the family's describing, but that they don't, you know, they don't do when they're in a clinic if you're in their house with them, even virtually. I also have seen things in family dynamics that I don't think you see again in a clinic. People are, you know, people comport themselves better when they're officially in a doctor's office, I think they do, than they do at home. So there's that as well.
Yeah, a much different kind of picture. And even before COVID, as, you know, a clinician going into their homes virtually, what kind of challenges were you experiencing?
The biggest challenges by far are technology challenges. Partly, early on, we're talking way back, especially in, you know, 2013-14, we sort of tracked who we invited to try the video visits and who declined. And a lot of the people who declined, the number one reason back then was lack of having a computer or internet access at home. So those numbers have gotten somewhat better. And I think, you know, certainly with a pandemic, people are motivated to get a device when they can afford one. And certainly in the VA, there's also mechanisms for supplying people with connected devices. So that has helped as well. But that's all newer. But lack of access to the technology, or lack of comfort with the technology, I think are still some of the biggest barriers. A lot of people are just not comfortable with the idea, or even if they want to try it, they don't have access. So I think that's the biggest barrier.
Yeah, and historically, one of the issues around access too was that the technology was a little bit cumbersome, as far as it wasn't just sending somebody a link to join. They had to do a couple of hurdles.
Yes.
What was it like for you? What kind of platform were you using? And
so early on, until I think a couple years ago, I was doing most of my video visits through the VA, where the platform was much clunkier to do home visits. It was very and that made it challenging, not so much for me, but for the families. They had to have a unique email for each visit, and they had to copy a password from that unique email into a completely different platform. And the password was one of those gobbledygook email, you know, passwords. And then we had to make sure, sometimes I would have a successful visit and then I'd go to do another visit a few months later and they couldn't connect. And it turned out that their computer was set to have remembered the password. And so, you know, it had stored the password from 3 months ago's visit, and now it didn't. And now they couldn't get on because, you know, just bypassed all sorts of problems. So it's much better with the current software. And the same thing is true at Mass General, because I was doing video visits pre-pandemic there as well. And the platform we had was also much clunkier and has become much more streamlined now during the pandemic. There was a while where it was very chaotic everywhere when everyone was scrambling. But I think at this point, it's come out the other side much easier from both the, you know, from the patient and provider side in terms of essentially just clicking on a link.
That's terrific. For our listeners who may be interested in specific software platforms, what are you using now? Are you using Zoom or Citrix or what platforms are working and what platforms have you been frustrated with?
Well, so at the VA, we now use something which I think is proprietary to the VA called VVC, which I think is Veteran Video Connect. And that is launched from an email that they get. So from their perspective, they literally just click on the link in the email and it is launched.
That sounds good.
Which is much better, and they don't have to have multiple windows open. I mean, before they had to have multiple windows open, which is hard for anybody.
Right. That sounds like Zoom. You just click on a link and boom, it's there.
Yep. And now, and for I know Mass General has changed platforms during the pandemic. We now have Zoom integrated into Epic. And so right in my schedule for the morning, there's a video camera icon next to each patient's name, and it turns green when they've checked in. And I literally click on the green video camera icon, and it launches my Zoom and my, you know. There's concerns because there's back at the beginning of the pandemic, they were allowing people to use almost any platform, and as we know, there was issues around privacy and stuff with Zoom and other platforms, which they've now addressed. HIPAA compliance.
You've never had a Zoom bomber interrupt a confidential.
I haven't. But like, for example, the Harvard default for all of the Harvard hospitals with Zoom is now that you have to admit people in from the waiting room. There's not an option to even undo that. It's a little challenging when you're having a research meeting and you have to admit every single member of the team, but definitely I understand why that's the default now.
So now as we go into the COVID era, and specifically, when you're, maybe we can dive down into the practical aspects of how you're thinking about assessment. You wrote this paper in the Journal of American Geriatric Society on using the geriatric 5M framework. So the 5Ms for our listeners are mind, mobility, medications, multi-complexity, and what matters most. You wrote a really wonderful paper on kind of how you also think about assessing the 5Ms using video visits. Is it okay if we kind of dive down into that? I'd love to start off with how you're thinking about the 5M framework, starting off with mind as far as when you're on those video visits. What are you actually doing?
So I think the mind part is obviously, as a cognitive behavioral neurologist, that's sort of my principal focus. In general, but you might be surprised to find that my approach is actually it's not super standardized. Perhaps because I'm a neurologist, I'm not using necessarily a formal screener. I'm not just screening people with a tool like an MMSE or a MoCA usually, but certainly I have those tools in my toolkit. My approach is actually, I'm in part of it maybe because I'm old enough to predate the MoCA and other tools that people now use as their, you know, only mental status tool. I generally do a large part of my mental status evaluation just talking to the patient. What they think, it's almost like the equivalent of chatting with them on the way in from the waiting room, just checking in and seeing how they're doing and asking them, you know, how about the Red Sox or whatever I think that they're interested, you know, if I know them already, what they're interested in. I find that a lot of, you can tell a lot if you just pay attention to how people are doing. Are they talking or are they deferring to the person with them? Are they answering my questions or are they evading them? If they say, you know, if I say, how have you been spending your time since I last saw you? And they are very vague. I try to pin them down. You know, can they actually discourse on what they claim to be interested in? Because often I'll find people who just sort of say something like, oh, well, you know, I don't really follow sports anymore once they've said that's what their main interest is. And then you say, well, what do you do with your time? And they say, well, I pretty much just watch TV. And then I'll say, what do you watch? You know, essentially trying to not just let that be chit-chat, but using it to interrogate them without them knowing it.
So it's kind of like, you know, when I think about like falls in a gait assessment, I feel like one of the best assessment is actually just watching your patient go from the waiting room into your clinic. And you can learn so much. It sounds like similar to here, like as an intern, you always learn like A&O times three, which is like the worst cognitive assessment out there. But rather just having a conversation, you can learn so much more about what's happening with your patient. Is that right?
And that is one of the things that, again, even outside the context of videos, I try to emphasize with trainees is that even if you don't do something formal, if I were to quiz you on what, you know, was he fluent or was he not fluent? Was he, you know, oriented or not? Was, you know, did they seem to have word finding problems? You probably know that if I just ask you. So it's really just a question of stepping back and realizing that, that if you increase your powers of observation and be mindful of their responses during your sort of chatting, that you actually are getting a fair amount of a mental status exam, or at least clues that there's maybe something up that you do need to assess more deeply.
And when you're assessing this, this could be, as you're doing the assessment, potentially emotionally challenging for the patient and if there's a caregiver. Do you ask for the caregiver to be there? And how do you balance talking to the caregiver, talking to the patient, like seeing how if there's disagreement or agreement?
I'd say that's potentially trickier in video. I think in person, when I'm, say, doing something more formal, like if I'm actually doing a pen and paper sort of standardized tool like a MoCA, I'm anti-MMSE, so I will not use that as an example. But I use some body language to make it clear that the person accompanying them is not to answer. I will say, you know, I'm just focused, you know, please, you know, I'm just trying to ask Mr. Jones these questions, so if you could keep quiet. I have to say that much more explicitly in a video call because they're both sitting there next to each other on the couch, right? I can't sort of turn my body and essentially use body language to exclude the other people in the room the way you can in a clinic visit. So I'm much more explicit, as I said, about that this is just for that, you know, I don't want the other person to help. Those issues also come up if somebody is potentially going to ask for help. You know, if you are testing somebody in your office, you can see if they're looking to the side and asking for help, or if they're writing words down when you're trying to have them learn words, you would see it. And I have yet to have that happen, but I have some of my neuropsychology colleagues have had people where they realized the person was writing stuff down, you know, or looking over at a calendar, looking at a calendar or the clock for orientation questions, right? So there are nuances to doing it in video, and you have to be somewhat mindful of them.
Yeah. I'm always like, I spend most of my time in the inpatient setting, and there's like a clock usually right on the wall. I'm always impressed how nobody actually ever looks at the clock when they're drawing the clock. That's a sign that, their right. cognitive status is pretty good. They know
they're
clock.
They're resourceful. Now. They're resourceful if they do that, right? So,
And let's say you do want to do a little bit more of a standardized cognitive screen. How are you doing that?
Well, so I do sort of small, medium, and large in terms of standardized. My most informal is much more of the sort of chit-chat version. And if they seem okay or about the same as they were last time I saw them, I might not go any farther. I sometimes do sort of just an on-the-fly mental status exam where I will sort of assess naming and learning. I'll hold things up that I just have in front of me. I don't like pens usually because that's a very high frequency word that's too easy to name. But I'll, you know, right here on my desk at home, I can ask people to name things. So I've just held up a stapler, for example, so that you can just grab things, you know, scissors, stapler, things that are on your desk, body parts, you know, ask people to name things and point to them, obviously ones that are visible on the screen. But I have also prepared, and again, I don't know that everyone needs to do this, but I have actually prepared a little PowerPoint presentation that I will do a share screen. It's just sort of the first part of roughly parallel to the MoCA, but it's not the MoCA since you're supposed to be licensed to do the MoCA, which I am, but not everyone is. But I have things like a picture of a cube to ask them to copy. And then I have instructions for drawing a clock sort of written out. And I ask them after they do things like that to just hold it up to the video camera. And I do a screenshot.
So you ask that they draw it on a piece of paper, yep. And then they hold that up to the camera. You take a picture of it, and yep. Then so you can look at it in more detail later.
Yep. And I sometimes incorporate them right into my note a picture of the bad clock they drew or something. Obviously, if they do it perfectly, it's not worth, you know, copying into the chart. So I've done that, and then I have some line drawings of things, again, from sort of high frequency easier words up to, you know, somewhat moderate frequency words which are harder to name. So I just have, you know, okay, just name these, and then the rest of the other things are just verbal, right? You can ask people to learn lists and to do many of the other elements, you know, do abstraction or serial sevens or all of those kind of things. Those are all just verbal. Again, potentially having to worry about people cheating. But again, I have not had that so much in a dementia context so far.
Like you said, that indicates resourcefulness, which is
right.
A pretty good
right.
cognition for that.
Was that the robust assessment?
I would say that's a robust assessment. And I mean, you know, again, most other things, if I'm going to do more, most of them are, you know, I probably have more time to do them than a primary care person. But I can do, you know, a full digit span, not just a screener version, but, you know, until people can no longer name the digits forward or backwards. You can do mm-hmm. all sorts of things. I actually have some other sort of parietal lobe screening tools that I'm fond of. I have a little paper on from fellowship about doing things with interlocking finger figures, which you can do by just sort of make sure that you're holding things up into the camera if people can see. You can do more than you might first think you can do, I would say, for cognitive assessment.
And do you ever
use... Some of it may take some planning, but if that's part of what you want to do, a small investment in time, I think, in practice, you will realize that you can do a lot more.
You mentioned the JAGS paper, potentially thinking about using like the MoCA version designed for blind people. Mm-hmm.
And that version is minus, you know, visual things. So if you don't want to spend the time to develop something where you put up a cube so that they can copy it and do the clocks and stuff, then you don't need to do that. But you can, I think anyone could ask somebody to do a clock drawing without putting up visual instructions and just ask them to hold it up. You could have them hold it up at each stage, you know, the circle, the numbers, and then drawing in the hands. Clock drawing is a very sensitive task, so that's a pretty good assessment.
Yeah. And any other practical advice for our listeners on assessing the first M mind, whether it be mood or mental state?
So I think the other aspects, you know, are similar to in person in that you ask if people have felt sad lately, tearful, etc. I think one wrinkle that's a little different is in some of our clinics, we have the person with dementia separate from the family caregiver who's the informant for part of the visit so that the family member can describe some things that would otherwise be upsetting to the person with dementia. And that is, you have to sort of orchestrate that ahead of time in a video visit in a way that you don't always have to in person in clinic. So I have a number of family members who would like to tell me about certain things about, say, delusions or, you know, violent outbursts or new incontinence issues, certain issues that come up in dementia management that they're not that comfortable talking about in front of the person with dementia. And so I have made it clear to most of my patients that if they want to do that, that we can start the visit at the time of the supposed start of the visit, it can be just me with the family member, and that they can then go get the person with dementia to join us for the later part of the visit. That's also easier in the house, right? By doing that virtually, the person with dementia may be sitting in the other room watching TV, and the family member just goes and says, you know, the doctor's here on this computer for you now. And in fact, we've been talking for 10 minutes.
And has that worked generally pretty well for you?
That works very well. So, and a lot of times if it's a, you know, 30 or 40 minute visit, the person with dementia, depending on their stage, their attention span is such that they don't want to sit there for that long anyway. I haven't had any of the patients with dementia push back on that. They're fine with, you know, just seeing me for 20 minutes and not 30 minutes.
And I guess also from a behavioral disturbances perspective, you probably get a sense of actually what the home environment looks like as far as thinking about how to address some of the behavioral disturbances that we see in dementia and potential triggers for that. Is that right?
Definitely. So often, you know, the person will, they'll kind of, they may get distracted and wander off, and you can kind of see what's distracted them. Or they may be very calm. I've had patients who look actually more calm than they do in the clinic, again, because they're a little agitated by being in the clinic. And yet on the video, they're sitting there and they're, say, petting their dog or, you know, fiddling with, you know, something that makes them more comfortable, or they get up and go to the bathroom and come back. They're not, you know, worried about not knowing where it is, for example, because they're just at home. So I've also get to see their environment in terms of other elements that are important for, you know, for dementia home safety issues, for example, knives, mm-hmm. knives in a knife block on the counter behind their head.
Oh boy.
Oh, right. Which, you know, lots of people have a knife block in their house, which is fine, yeah. but in certain settings and stages of dementia, we worry about that you know,
sure.
grabbing a knife out of the knife block, or you can see a lot of clutter. You know, I've had yeah. people who, you know, the burden of caregiving is such that they're not able to, you know, keep up with housekeeping as well. And it just sort of snowballs to the point where they're really, their house is very cluttered. And now it's also, you know, fall risk and is adding to the tension in the room, and, you know, in the home too.
Yeah, so. I really appreciated how in your JAGS paper you started off with the story of this person who, through the challenges of video and the two-dimensional screen, you got a sense of what's important to him when he wandered off the screen and came back with a painting from his art class. And so this idea of trying to understand, like, what's meaningful to patients and their caregivers, and the ability to elicit that in the home setting better than it might be in the clinic.
I also, there's another patient I didn't mention in the article who I think of who was one of my earliest patients, whose wife, I had seen them a number of times in the clinic first, because this was when I was transitioning to trying the video at home stuff. And he'd always come with his son. And his son didn't live with him. His son lived nearby, but his, you know, brought him to all the visits because his wife, who was the primary caregiver, was in a wheelchair. So I'd never met the primary caregiver until I then did a video visit with them. And now here, you know, because it was so much work to bring the wife also in the car to the clinic, now I was able to have a direct conversation with the wife, and I could really see this sort of dynamics between this quite physically spry person with dementia and this quite cognitively with it, but physically limited wife, and this really interesting, you know, complementary partnership that they had that I would not have appreciated in just our in-person clinic.
Well, let's talk a little bit about maybe some practical pearls on the other four of five M's. So you already talked a little bit about mobility and the advantage of seeing what the home looks like. You know, are there slip rugs, you know, other things that could be an issue of mobility? Any other pearls that you have as far as when you're looking for that mobility M?
I think, you know, if they're getting up to go get something from the other room, or the person, you know, I have had them ask if, you know, excuse themselves and say that they want to go do something. And I'm fine with that, partly because I do get to see them walk, right? I can see, do they need to use their arms to push up from the chair? Do they just stand up? Do they need somebody to help them get up? Do they forget to, you know, do they have to be reminded to use the walker, right? You get all yeah. that in the home in a way that you can get some of that in the clinic, but some of it is actually, again, extra in the home, because if they're in your clinic room, their walker is one of the only things there. They're less likely to forget it, right? Yeah. It's right there in front of them, but if it's among things. But, you know, if you want to do more of an assessment, I have checked people for tremor and stuff. You can just have people, you know, hold their hands out to check for tremor, because as you know, there's a lot of Parkinsonism that comes in later stages of many forms of dementia. So it's not perfect. Yeah. I definitely think that motor exam is not as good as, you know, in person. But
yeah, you know, I'm thinking back to med school. The only time in med school I was ever taught about a gait assessment was in my neurology rotation. Any tips as far as, because I can imagine, like, seeing somebody's complete gait on a Zoom camera may be difficult because you're only seeing a part of it. Any tips for assessing gait on Zoom?
So I confess I have not tried as much, but I think you would, you know, depending on their home orientation and where they're direct, you know, where they're going to go get something for you or entering the room, you may only see a little snippet, as you said.
Yeah.
I think if you're concerned about their gait, you have to ask them to position the camera, you know, to position the camera such that you could see into, you know, as they walk into the next room and back or down the hallway or something.
Yeah.
Which brings up, you know, that a lot of doing these video visits into the home, there is no tech, right? You are the technologist, you're advising, you are essentially trying to coach the family in doing some of the tech. You know, we have help getting them set up initially with the technology, but I do a lot of coaching about how to unmute or how to adjust the lighting so that I can see their face. You have to be prepared to do a little of that tech troubleshooting on your own. So,
real quick, other M's. So we're going on to medications. Any pearls around assessing medications?
So for me, the big pearl is that they have all their medications there at their house somewhere, right? So you could potentially do a more thorough medication reconciliation in the home than you might be able to do in clinic, because there are all those, you know, PRN meds that they don't mention to you, and over-the-counter things and vitamins. And I've had patients who say that they're taking some kind of nutraceutical or, you know, Chinese herbal mix or something like that, and I don't know what it is. I don't know it by the brand, and they will say, hey, I'll go get it. And they bring it back and they can either read it to me or at least show me the label so I can Google it and look up what it is that they're taking. Where if in person, you wouldn't have known. They would just say, oh, and I'm taking something that my healer gave me, and you don't really know what it is. So those are some additional benefits, I'd say. You can find out what that new prescription that somebody in a different medical system network gave them, or they just go get it.
Yeah. All right, last two. Multi-complexity. You give a couple stories, including in your JAGS article, including the opportunity to meet a patient's adult child with special needs and learning that it's not really making future plans for the patient with dementia, but also her daughter as well. I love that, thinking about multi-complexity, not just like somebody with lots of organ, you know, dysfunction or comorbidities, but like what everything around them may be complex.
Right. A complex social set, you know, social network. Most people, you know, it's not just them and their one caregiver they live with or something like that. There's a whole complex network of people and financial burdens that they suffer. And I think it's, you sort of see that writ large in their home. You get a sense of what that network is and what some of those other challenges are. Again, if you look.
Yeah. And last one, last M is what matters most. Any practical tips around assessing for this?
So I think that a lot of what you see in their home can be good conversation starters, if you will, to ask them about what matters most. You know, is it living longer because of their granddaughter's upcoming wedding, you know, or is it about being able to continue with that hobby that they really love because they just came and showed you this, you know, model boat that they've built or whatever. It really is a sort of entree into those conversations that's, I think, a little different than in the abstract in a kind of clinic or hospital setting. And I do feel like I've visited their home by visiting their home through video in a way that is more personal, and that I think many of them appreciate that it's almost like a house call. Like you've really gone into their house. And so having that conversation again, doesn't feel quite as clinical. It feels like a real conversation with another, you know, not that we're not humans, but just, you know, I'm in their home. So that conversation is in the context of a, not just scary clinical setting.
That's such an optimistic and refreshing and encouraging view of video visits, at first blush, you're like, oh my gosh, I have to meet this person through a screen, as you describe, a two-dimensional view. And yet you're talking about how this opens up a level of, you know, relationship with patients that is similar to making house calls, because you're invited into their home, because you're seeing them in their closer to natural state outside of the clinic setting. And because of that level of intimacy of being, you know, a window into what's happening in the home setting. So it's a fascinating contrast.
And obviously, I don't want to paint a picture saying it's all, you know, it's all roses. I think the technology challenges are the flip side of that. That's really been, you know, there's you know, audio lag and video lag and challenges with access. And so as much as I'm painting, you know, a rosy picture, I also feel bad that not everyone can necessarily do it. But I would say from the point of view of clinicians, I do hope that people realize that if you just think of it that way and open your eyes to what you can observe and some of those opportunities, that they can be really rich.
Okay, one question. If you had a magic wand, you can make one change as far as how what providers do, or potentially from a policy perspective or healthcare systems perspective to encourage use of virtual home visits. Do you have an idea what that would be?
I would make it so that everyone has access to high quality broadband and geriatric, shall we say, friendly devices. I guess I think that a lot of our technology has become so complex. I mean, these smartphones are just so complicated, and there's, you know, everything is just so complex, and so many people don't have access. So if I could make, I don't know if that's even beyond policy. That's a sort of pie in the sky thing. But I would love if everyone had, if the technology was not the limiting factor, and it was, you know, I really think that that would be my dream.
So here's my last question. I hosted a session for UCSF alumni. We'll put a link to this in the show notes about will video visits and telemedicine endure beyond COVID? And I'm interested in your perspective on this. Like, when this madness is all over, and of course you're doing this beforehand, what's the landscape going to look like?
I think that there's going to be a lot more video visits. I think that the people have now crossed that threshold of, you know, that people were afraid to try it, were sure it wouldn't work, or were biased about who they thought could do it. And this pandemic has forced people to challenge those notions and to try it. And that now the genie's sort of out of the bottle. I don't think it's going to replace in-person visits, but I think it will replace some, will and should replace some visits. I usually suggest that people, you know, if you start somebody on a new blood pressure medication and it's part of a comprehensive visit, and then instead of making them come in for a blood pressure check and to tune up that, you know, that one medication, or you just started an antidepressant or whatever, that 3-week check or whatever could very easily be a video visit, and that a video visit is richer than a phone visit and is not as, you know, burdensome as an in-person visit.
Yeah. And I got to say, we can't rewind. We've gone too far.
I agree.
Good tie-in.
There you go.
All right, a little bit more of the song. Here we go.
And now we meet in an abandoned studio. We hear the playback and it seems so long ago. And you remember the jingles used to go. You were the first one. You were the last one. Video kill the radio star. Video kill the radio star. In my mind and in my car. We can't rewind, we've gone too far.
I love that last line. We can't rewind, we've gone too far. I think that's a great song choice for this session. Lauren, very big thank you for joining us on today's podcast.
Thank you. This is fun.
And to all of our listeners, thank you for joining us. Please share us one social media share out there on Twitter, Facebook, or anything else that you're listening to. And a big thank you to Archstone Foundation for your continued support. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody. Thank you.